But why don't we move on to maybe an album I think we're both a little more interested to talk about. Coldplay's Everyday Life. Coldplay, man, interesting, because when they released their last album in 2017, and I'm blanking on the name of it. Give me 1 second to find it in my notes here. 2017 Head Full of Dreams, sorry. 2017's Head Full of Dreams. It kind of seemed like Coldplay might either be moving towards a hiatus, or potentially maybe even kind of coming to the end as a band. They did like this whole documentary about their career as a band. They released this live album that they recorded and all these on their big world tour along with the album. And then kind of out of the blue, about like a month or two ago, they started dropping some singles and alluding that there's a new album on the way, and they're even calling this a double album. And I think interest in Coldplay have been waning a bit. You know, they start off their careers as the Fix You guys, the guys who make these really kind of like sappy but still comforting songs that are these rock ballads, but they don't really challenge you, and they're a pretty safe band, I think, for the most part. And they kind of wanted to just become more and more pop and more safe, it felt like, until, you know, every teardrop is a waterfall feels like the perfect metaphor, where it just is like, I roll my eyes every time I read the titles because it just feels so ridiculous. And
textbook arena rock.
Right. And then they dropped this album, Everyday Life, and it feels like a bit of a shift for the band. And it's a shift in a direction more towards, I think, a musical and singer-songwriter stripped back side of the band, which is really interesting. But I'm not sure if it all landed for me. I'm wondering how you felt, knowing that, one, you like rock that goes hard, and this is certainly not that. But knowing that, you know, Coldplay, this is a shift for them as a band in general, too. Like, how did you feel about this album?
Yeah, I do respect the willingness to change and evolve as an act. And I think it's at least a more interesting pivot than just becoming a more homogeneous pop like a lot of these big bands have gone, at least this decade. But I think Coldplay, because they're much older, more established act, and clearly seem to have some integrity in what they believe and care about as they've grown wealthy and old. I think that's commendable. But yeah, I mean, the first note I wrote down was Chris Martin got woke, dog, you know? And
yeah,
hearing him talk about these things, it does sound like he really cares. And, you know, following Radiohead's footsteps in terms of really caring about like sustainable, environmentally conscious touring, which is not super easy when you're an arena band. Looking no further than U2 when they had that big claw set that required like hundreds of trucks, and it was basically a moon landing every time they moved the set. I think, an important undertaking, because this is something that really has real impact. And I really respect that, and I'm happy to hear that from someone that famous. But yeah, it's still soft, and that's not the rock I enjoy. So this, you know, I mean, what's it, that third, was it the third track? That one where there's the voiceover from the police officer, give an attitude. And I'm like, okay, I get what you're going for. Then later on, I forget what song was, but there's talks about guns, and clearly it's a gun control message. And I'm like, okay, I mean, I respect all of this, but and honestly, I don't think it's that offensive to Coldplay fans, because as we've been saying, Coldplay is not, they've always kind of been sappy. So I don't think this whole, like, adding these songs into their sets when they eventually do perform or tour again is not going to feel offensive or out of left field when those songs come on, like some other bands, like fifth albums tracks might, you know, like the Arctic Monkeys last album, the Tranquility Hotel Base Casino, an album people like, but definitely a lot different than their past stuff. And you notice when they start playing those new tracks, right? I don't think that's the case at all. This still kind of fits in, but yeah, it's still Coldplay. Like, and I think what's important to remember about Coldplay is that when they did the Super Bowl, no one remembered they did it. They remembered Bruno Mars and Beyonce.
That's a great point. Some of the songs you're talking about, Trouble in Town, which also leads into another song I really liked off the album, Broken, with a capital E, not sure what the going on there, but okay. I thought those were two really good tracks. Like you said, it kind of bringing in the recording of the racial profiling incident in Philadelphia, kind of added to the track and creates this, you know, makes you think, tries to make you woke a bit. But the song that I think is at, you know, obviously the center of this and that I think will fit best into their live act is Arabesque. It's one of the singles. It's a swing song that actually was one of the last cuts from Viva La Vida, or Viva, whatever it is, and all her friends.
Yeah, you got it.
And I think that makes a lot of sense because it's probably the song that's most appealing. I think the most like fun and like you kind of want to move to it. And it comes from a totally different time of their career before they moved into this generic poppiness. So I thought that was pretty interesting. I also thought Orphans, another song that's a little bit more more old school Coldplay, I think could fit in well to their live songs. Overall, I think it's an interesting listen, and it was pretty quick, which is also, you know, for 16 songs and Coldplay calling this a double album, it's shorter than a lot of their other longer albums. So I think these like 2-3 minute tracks actually go by pretty quickly.
Yeah, was it a Sunrise and Sunset are the two sides?
Yeah,
I think conceptually that's actually it does seem to work, and it's funny because like calling something a double album in 2019 means little to most people, you know, beyond oh, it's just a long one, you know, like doesn't have an impact anymore because no one actually has the double discs. So it seems like they actually were able to execute. So that's cool.